Bronsty from Pakistan, but he's a Fulbright scholar working here in the college for this year. Yeah, we are very excited for him to give us a presentation on microRNA, which perhaps everybody heard about it. I'm very curious about this technique too.
Thank you, Dr. Sobhi. It's nice for me to be here. Good afternoon, everyone. I think it is afternoon, yes?
Yes.
So today I'm going to talk some basics and the approach that I used for the microRNA. And the title of my presentation is microRNA, miRNA, mRNA, which we call now the mega regulators. The mega regulators in the eukaryote genome. As Dr. Sopping already told, I just want to repeat it. I am a Fulbright visiting scholar here from Pakistan and belong to one of the provinces in Pakistan which is called Balochistan. And my university name is University of Balochistan, the same like here, the state Tennessee. Here the term province is used instead of the state. So, University of Balochistan and my department is botany, plant science. So, we are already familiar with the basic RNA tree. That RNA are basically two types. One is coding and second is non-coding. The coding RNA means the RNA that contain information for the protein, which involve in the translation directly and copied in the form of protein. And this is called coding RNA, and there is only one example, and that is mRNA. Messenger RNA is just a single example of the coding RNA. And the rest of the RNAs in the RNA world are non-coding RNAs. And we know that non-coding RNAs are much more than the coding RNAs. Almost 95 to 97% are the non-coding RNAs in the total transcriptome of the eukaryotes. And in them, we are mostly familiar with the transcription RNAs, the translational RNAs like ribosomal RNA and transfer RNA. rRNA or tRNA. But there is also an interesting type which is called small RNAs. And in these small RNAs, one important type is miRNA or microRNA. Although here is siRNA, small nuclear RNA, small nuclear RNA, but today we are going to talk about the only one class, that is miRNA microRNA. Now next, what is microRNA? So these are some basic terms that explain, that define, that tell us about microRNA. Means these are the features, these are the characters which tell us about the microRNA. The first is endogenes. That microRNA are naturally present inside the living organisms. They are not belong from the outside. They are inside the living organism, so they are endogenous. This is the one of the property of the microRNA. And the second, they are a class of the small RNA. So this is the small RNA in size, and this its length ranges from 18 to 26 nucleotide. What I observe in my research, I observe the minimum 18 nucleotide and maximum 26 nucleotide of the miRNA or the microRNA in plant and animals. And second, the third property is it is non-coding. The same as we discussed earlier, that it's not code for any type of protein, it is non-coding. And the next, now when it is non-coding, what it is its function? It is regulator, negative regulator. It controls the mRNA conversion into protein. So and their type of control, their type of gene regulation is called post-transcriptional gene regulation. Mean after transcription, after mRNA synthesizing, after mRNA creation, the step that go to control the gene expression is the post-transcriptional gene regulators, and microRNA is their type of molecule, and it is present in animal, plants, and viruses. And another property is that it is single-stranded. Now, I always give more force on this term that it is single-strand, not a double-strand. It is initially single-strand, but it is self-complementary. It is self-complementary. Within the same strand, it contains the repeats, it contains the complementary sequences, which causes the self-folded structure. But always remember, when we go to classify the RNA world in two groups, the coding and the non-coding, then for the coding we have only one example, messenger RNA, and messenger RNA is always linear, or in some cases it is circular to increase the translation rate in some cases. Now, and that linear RNA is capped by some special protein, which are SSBP, single strand binding protein, and rest all non-coding RNA need our non-coding RNA develops some secondary structure by interaction with the sequences within the RNA, and their secondary or tertiary structure is essential for their work. The one famous example is the tRNA. If the tRNA has some secondary and tertiary structure, without their tertiary or secondary structure, they couldn't able to work. They're not able to perform their function. So all non-coding RNA must some sort of secondary structure, and that secondary structure is essential for their work.
So in the microRNAs, is it hairpins just like the tRNA?
Let me go into those. Okay. Now, so the same is here. It develops some sort of secondary structure, and their secondary structure is called stem loop or hairpin structure. And this is the example. So this is the example. This is the stem, and this is the loop. So it develops due to self-complementary, the single strand bind with each other, develop a complementary structure. This can restructure, and it is stem and then loop. So it develop a stem loop, or which is also called hairpin, because it resembles with the pin that the girls or the women are used for their hair. So hairpin structure. Yes. So and then next we need to know about the three terms about the microRNA. That these are the primary microRNA, precursor microRNA, and mature microRNA. So the primary microRNA is the initial microRNA, which later convert into precursor microRNA, and it has properties matching with the messenger RNA, that it contains poly A tail at the 3 prime and capping at the 5 prime. This is very interesting, that it is non-coding, it is not involved in the protein synthesizing, but it contains the properties which is similar to the messenger RNA. It contains poly A tail, it contains the 5 prime cap. And due to this, nowadays, in one or two papers, they use the term non-coding messenger RNA. Maybe I am not agree with them, but in some papers, nowadays, they use the term non-coding messenger RNA on the basis of these properties. And then the capping and the tail will be removed, and it will develop a next structure which is smaller in size to this one. This one is the primary, denoted by PRI Mirna, and then it converted into a precursor Mirna. Now, precursor is a structure, is a stage from where microRNA matures. So, and it inland to the primary, but more inland than the mature microRNA. And this is the double strand. In these two strands, the red one here represented as a mature microRNA whose length ranges from 18 to 26, and it is actually involved in the gene regulation. And this mature is represented by miRNA. So always, if anywhere you just reading this term, then it means it is about the short sequence miRNA, the mature one. And when there is this type of PRE mRNA, it means it is about the stem loop sequence, it is about the precursor mRNA, where the mature is a part of the stem. And when it is the PRE, so it is primary microRNA. And the thing, now there are the two strands. One is maturing into mature microRNA, and the second is a carrying of the is the supporter of the mature, and this is called the passenger microRNA. This is called the passenger microRNA, and this passenger microRNA help it to provide support, to provide to prevent it from degradation in the cytoplasm, and this later it degrade, and only mature one go to perform the role of gene regulation. The next is she. When, from where this microRNA come and who is defining and reporting this? So, the first microRNA was LIN4. The first microRNA reported was LIN4. It is stand for lineage 4, reported by Lee et al. In 1993 in C. elegans. In C. elegans, a nematode. So, this is the their discovery. This microRNA was involved in the development, and they were this Lee and his group working on the this developmental stages to understand how the different development occur in the C. elegans, and then they found that there is a type of RNA which is LIN4. It involved to control the expression of the LIN14. LIN14 is a messenger RNA, is a protein coding RNA, and it is controlled by another type of RNA which is LIN4. But later they found that this was non-coding and it exists in two forms, LIN4S small and LIN4L large. They found that this LIN4 was in two form, were present in the C. elegans, in small form and in large form. Actually, they find one the mature and the second the precursor, both form what they observed, so they use the term small and long. And they also found that it interacts, it has some complementary sequences in the 3' UTR of the LIN14, in the 3' of the untranslated region of the LIN14, and this 20, and it is 21 nucleotide in size, and it go to complementary hybridized with the 3' UTR of the LIN14, and then it don't regulate LIN14 via an action of antisense RNA-RNA interaction, because at that time the RNA intersense term was more acceptable as compared to the microRNA. And then after 7 years, after 1993, after 7 years, 2000, the second microRNA was discovered, and it was lead 7. It is also discovered in C. elegans, and it is also involved in the development. So at that time, in 2001, they were named small temporal RNA. That these are the small RNA, and they involve in the temporal program of the living organism. So they are called strRNA. But in 2001, Liu et al. Discovered that these small RNA are abundantly present in C. elegans, in other invertebrates and invertebrates, and they have role in the regulatory. They are not only work as a developmental, they also work in other stages. So then they used the term microRNA for the first time in 2001, meaning now the first discovery in 1993 and the term was given in 2001. Now next, as I'm working on plant, so when the first plant microRNA is discovered, the first plant microRNA were discovered in 2002 by Rainer et al. And these were 16 microRNAs from Arabidopsis ephemeris, flowering plant. So, and now S155 were already reported in animals. So, the first one microRNA that was reported here by Rainer et al. In Arabidopsis, it was named 156. So, the first microRNA in plant is MIR 156 to 171, as these are the 160, and these are the microRNA that they reported. These are the 156 A, B, C, so these are the same stem loop sequence. The mature one is represented in red and it is present in the stem region, and this the box representing the passenger strand. So this is the 5 type of 156. And then they also found that out of 16, 8 were also conserved in the rice. Mean 8 were also present in the rice. Now this was the first evidence which showing that microRNA are conserved between dicot and monocot, because Arabidopsis is a dicot plant and rice is a monocot. So this was the first evidence. And then, now let's take a brief concept of how they generate, how microRNA create in the living organism, their biogenesis. The microRNA genes are initially transcribed by the RNA polymerase to the same polymerase that involved in the creation of the messenger RNA. So, and it creates, when initially the first microRNA was transcribed, which is the same that we discussed in the previous slide. It is primary microRNA containing the 3' poly A tail and 5' capping, and in some cases it is also generated by the polymerase 3. So nowadays it is accepted that both RNA polymerase 2 and RNA polymerase 3 involve to generate this class of RNA. The primary mRNA, microRNA contains stem loop scale restructure, either maybe one, maybe more, and when they are more, then it is, and that stem loop structure is called the precursor microRNA. Already we take that concept. And this primary microRNA are processed in the nucleus by the help of a microprocessor complex, mean it contains many proteins, many enzymes, and in these, one of the important is the RNase-3. This RNase-3 enzyme is called Drusha, and it involved to digest the double-strand RNA, and it is, there is also binding protein which have in it, and there is a PASHA-RBGCR8 which help to recognize this primary microRNA for the RNase-3 enzyme Drusha. The precursor microRNA hairpin were generated through this cutting, and it is then exported to the cytoplasm, and in the cytoplasm it further processed to develop a small double strand structure which is 18 to 26 nucleotide in length, and its one strand is mature microRNA, and it is processed by RNase-3 protein which here is called dicer in animal and dicer-like enzyme BCL in plants. Now the mature microRNA here incorporates into another protein complex which is familiar one, RISC, RNA induced silencing complex, and this RISC then negatively regulates the gene expression, take the mature microRNA to the messenger RNA where its target where its sequence is present, it go to bind with the portion of the messenger RNA, and then it start the either the inhibition of the translation or it start the degradation of the messenger RNA. And this depend on the number of complementary sequences between the microRNA and the messenger RNA. If it is partial sequences match, then it only inhibit the translation. If it is perfect or near perfect match, it involve in the degradation. Now it is a popular concept that in animal there is a partial complementary approach between microRNA and messenger RNA, which involve in the inhibition, and in plants there is a perfect or near perfect approach which involve in the degradation. Then this is the same story in the graphic form, that these are the DNA, intergenic, intronic. So there is another approach, that microRNA is also present in the intron region, in the intron region of the messenger RNA. So it is intronic region, maybe there it present. It is also in form of polycystronic, many microRNA in the same precursor, in the same primary. And then these are the primary, it develop into precursor, then it transport into the cytoplasm, and then here it develop a duplex containing passenger strand, which represented by miRNA steric and miRNA mature, and it the mature one is incorporated into the RISC complex, and it go to either having to repress the translation or to repair the messenger RNA. Next, microRNA nomenclature, the naming system for the microRNA. Actually, its name consists of three units. So in the three units, the first unit is for the organism. The first unit made up of three letters, and three letters represent the organism to which this microRNA belong. The first letter is for the genus, and the second two letters are for the species. For the species of the particular organism, for example here, if it is ATH, it means Arabidopsis thaliana. And the second unit signifies the type of microRNA, the stage. Either it is precursor, or it is the gene, or it is the mature one. So if it is precursor, then the all small alphabets, small case, lower case, is used. MIR for precursor, and MI with capital R for mature, and all the three in capital for the gene are for the primary one. So this is the second, and then the third is a number, and it signifies the sequential discovery order of the microRNA. As already we take previous, that there 155 were discovered in the animal, so the next one was discovered in plant, and it was named 156. So the order of their discovery. Now next, there are the letters like 156A and 156B. These means that they are same microRNA with different precursor, different location in the genome, and then they use the suffixes A, B. And also sometimes the both strand of the duplex, the passenger strand also act as a mature, and the mature one is also act as a mature. So then they denote the term 3 prime and 5 prime for the to create a difference between the microRNA. For example here, if it is 5 prime, mean it is on the 5 prime end of the stem loop sequence, or it is also 3 prime, it is on the 3 prime. When both the duplex, both the strand act as a mature RNA. Now next concept, microRNA clusters. It means more microRNA can exist, can present in single either primary microRNA or precursor microRNA. When it is in primary, it is called primary microRNA cluster. When it is in precursor, it is called precursor microRNA cluster. The Figure A is the example of the precursor. This one is the precursor. The first one. The A is the precursor, where the lung representing the mature one. These are the mature ones. So one mature, one precursor, one is here, this mature, this here, this one, there. So many different microRNA are present in one family. This is our primary microRNA cluster. This is the precursor microRNA cluster. Here, many microRNA are present in the primary, so that is our primary microRNA cluster. Normally, it was accepted that the two microRNA they present in the region of maximum 3 kb distance, they will be considered as a cluster. Next, microRNA targets. MicroRNA, like already we discussed in the previous slide, that microRNA go to target a specific RNA molecule which is called messenger RNA. So its target is messenger RNA. It's not directly protein. It's going to react with the messenger RNA, and the famous example are the transcription factors. The transcription factors proteins, mean the mRNA for the transcription factor, this is the famous example. And their targets are mostly present in the 3' UTR, mostly, not entirely. The microRNA go to bind with the 3' untranslated region of the messenger RNA, and there is also a concept that one microRNA may regulate many messenger RNA, and similarly one messenger RNA may regulate by many microRNAs. And then there is a specific region which interact between the microRNA and mature the messenger RNA, and this specific region is called seed, or seed region, or seed site, and it is 2 to 7 or 8 to 13 from the 5' of microRNA. Like here, this region from 2 to 7, from 2 to 7. So this is the seed region, and this is essential, must be present between the microRNA and its targeted messenger RNA. Then role in biological processes, where microRNA work, where microRNA regulate. Now, it's better to ask the question, where not microRNA regulate? Because microRNA regulate each and every step, every biological process, either from development and growth, organogenesis, cell signaling, metabolism, cell division, transportation, biotic stresses, etc. So this is the reason we call them mega regulators. They are the mega regulator of the eukaryotic genome. Now, the another thing that we found for the microRNA is that the precursor is also conserved with the mature one. While mostly the different groups reported that mature microRNA is conserved, but we found that precursor is also conserved. This is one of the precursor sequence containing two mature microRNA, and we found that the entire precursor is conserved in the 5 different species. Then Mirbase, the microRNA database. Mirbase, although there are many different databases on the World Wide Web, but the famous one, or the authentic one, is the Mirbase. It is a microRNA database. It is a searchable database of published microRNA sequences and annotation. And Mirbase is the microRNA registry resource which initially set up by Sam Griffith-Jones in 2003, and it is standard based, and the URL is provided here. And this is showing the growth of the publication in the field of microRNA and the sequences at the Mirbase. So on the left, the sequences in the Mirbase, on the right, the publication in the PubMed with term microRNA, and on the x-axis at the bottom there is the year. So you can observe that after 2010, this number was rises exponentially very highly, and it is reaching maximum to 2013. So, and here I also want to that all the microRNA are not available on the Mirbase, because Mirbase is an optional database for the people, for the scientists who are going to submit their sequences, not as compulsory as in the case of the EST or in the case of the gene sequences, which you should first deposit with some either the NCBI or the DDBJ or the AMBL, and then later go to publish it. This is not the case in the microRNA. You can publish microRNA without submission, without getting the accession number or submitting it to the some sort of database. So this is the reason that we also go to analyze the literature and the database parallel to get the maximum information about particular species microRNAs. Now, the latest Mirbase release, which was version 20, released in June 2013, it contained 24,521 microRNA, and it is belong to 206 species. Now, if you compare this with the remaining domain of the molecular biology, if you go to search the number of ESTs with the organism, the number of proteins with the organisms, and other things, it is very less as compared to them. So this creates the idea. This forced us to work on the microRNA and to find them in different organisms where they are not reported. So mostly I work in this way. Now, approaches to identify new microRNAs. There are two types of microRNAs. The term for this one is the conserved and second is the species-specific microRNA. The conserved microRNA are the microRNA that are present in the different species of the plants or animals, and the species-specific, which are present only one species. And the approaches, there are the two approaches, the dry-lab bioinformatic or the comparative genomic approach, and the second is the wet-lab or nowadays small RNA libraries approach. So, through dry-lab is best to, the bioinformatic approach is best to identify the conserved microRNAs, and the wet-lab approach is best to identify the species specific and also some conserved, not all as in case of dry lab. Now, identification of the new conserved microRNA. Now we have a concept that plant and animal genome has conserved small non-coding microRNAs. The conserved nature makes them a good source for new microRNA discovery by homology search using bioinformatic tools. First, they are conserved. Second, this conservation is good to find new candidate in the new species through homology search. And third, many microRNA are still missing in many important plants and animals. If you here you just take a plant name like onion, anyone other is important. So still they are not microRNA reported in those plants. So a systematic search approach is used for interspecies catalog of microRNA precursor from known sequences in GenBank. So this is the approach that we use in our lab. Now, this is the specific approach methodology for microRNA identification. This is the dry lab approach. This is the computational approach. What we take first, we take all the known microRNAs from the microRNA registry database. We take all the entire microRNA sequences, both the precursor and the mature, and then we go to assemble them, to check them, to remove the repeated one, to, so in this way we generate a final list that these will be used to the downstream studies. And then we use to for the homology search, we use the program BLAST, basic local alignment search tool, the famous one, to enlarge it with the EST and GSS database, genomic survey sequence and the express sequence states. So in the NCBI to blast it against them to find the similar sequence. And the criteria, the first criteria is any sequence which containing mature microRNA from 0 to 4 mismatches. Mean we take the Arabidopsis 156 microRNA, both mature and precursor, blast it against our desired plant, for example switchgrass, and then we check it for the mature one, for maximum 4 mismatches is accepted at this stage. And then next we go to blast it against with the same organism EST database. Mean if it is we working on the switchgrass, we blast it against the switchgrass EST database, and the purpose of this is to remove the repeated ESTs, to remove the repetition and to create the single tone, and then next to check the conservation between the reference microRNA precursor and the newly candidate.